I was obsessed with Bette Midler. And did that kind of obsession constitute early addictive behavior? Or was I just like a fan of a celeb? So the definition of an addiction, like what makes it an addiction, is when you're doing something compulsively and you can't stop doing it despite it having negative consequences in your day-to-day life. So was Bette Midler having negative consequences in my life? Yes, guys, so many. Like, my grades were plummeting because my brain only had room for Bette Midler. And it was like damaging my family relationships. Like my brother, Joseph, he's 4 years older, such a peaceful boy. Like in my house, he was like a little Buddha in my house, never raised his voice. I played the song Wind Beneath My Wings so many times on repeat that my brother became so irate that he found the CD and he brought it to the dinner table one night. I remember we had eye contact and he snapped it in front of me. And my parents were like, we support him. It was extreme. I'm gonna move on from Bette Midler. This is not a show about Bette Midler, but I do wanna tell you one more thing about Bette Midler. So, can I tell you my go-to fantasy when I was a kid, and this was like a daydream that I would just play out in my head, a scenario that I would think about when I was in class, failing my classes, because I was thinking about Bette. Okay, and to be honest, it's a very potent fantasy to this day. Like, when I think about my dream relationship dynamic and what I'm looking for in a relationship, it's this, okay. It's Bette Midler. It's Las Vegas. So in the fantasy, Bette's doing a residency at Caesar's Palace. It's called An Evening with Bette. It's a big production, big brass band, huge. Has anyone seen Bette Midler live? What are we doing with our lives? We need to get on this, but get on YouTube tonight and search Bette Midler live, because she's like an old school performer, right? Like a sort of vaudeville, sassy, so confident, comes out feather boa, like so much, like more of a woman than we could ever dream of being ourselves. She comes out, she's like, hello, boys, like that. It's crazy. Everyone gets an erection immediately. And she's about like sort of snappy sexual innuendo and one-liners in that Mae West style tradition where it's like very snappy, cool. Like, oh, did somebody open a window or am I Bette Midler? Better than that. But like, is that a haircut? Are you happy to see me? That doesn't make sense, but like that. So in the fantasy, Bette's doing the show, smashing it out of the park night after night. I'm just her stage manager, okay? So I'm all dressed in black. I like to think maybe my name is Joanne. I'm incredibly stressed out. I'm wearing like a headset and I have a clipboard and I'm just drenched in sweat. I'm overworked, I'm underpaid. But I'm like the glue that keeps the show running smoothly. So I'm passing her feather boas from offstage. She walks up, doesn't even make eye contact with me, takes them out of my hands. The show ends, standing ovation for Bette. She comes off stage. She's still like buzzing from the show. So she's bantering with industry backstage. She's like, oh, put that in your contract, Mr. DeVille. I'm like, excuse me, Bette's very tired. If we can make a path for the green room, please. Excuse me, Bette's very tired. She's still signing people's dicks as she was. There's like a row of dicks. She's just signing all the dicks. Finally, we get her back to the green room. I have all her favorite drinks and snacks laid out. And finally, she's like, good night, everyone. And the door closes and she collapses into my arms in a state of exhausted vulnerability that only I get to see. Thank you.